Oh, yeah. Good afternoon, everyone. Today, David and I will be performing De Vieni non tardar from Mozart's Le Nozze di Figaro. And at this stage in the opera, it's towards the end, and Susanna has concocted a plot with the Countess to catch the Count out in his infidelity by swapping clothes. So she will be dressed as the Countess, and the Countess will be dressed as her. At this point, she is singing about her love for the Count as a way to tease Figaro, who is hiding, watching her. He thinks he's hiding, but she knows that he's there, and so she sings of her love for the Count, and then it turns into her love for Figaro.
Thank you. the music here. Is this yours? Are you?
Yeah,
all right. Oh, good idea. Let's bring this down here. And I'll just put it a little lower. Mm-hmm. Is that all right?
Yeah.
Okay, so beautiful singing. This is the ideal aria for Cleo. Perfect Susanna sound. It's really great. It's a fantastic aria. It's absolutely wonderful. We've had, probably by this time, we've almost been there for 4 hours watching this opera. It's at the end of a very, very long day, and I believe that Mozart or Da Ponte named the aria incorrectly. It should be The Marriage of Susanna, because she's the one who makes everything happen in this opera. And beautifully done. It's a classic aria with this lovely accompanied recitative and then going into a really beautiful lyric aria at the end. I just want to just give you a few ideas to be thinking about for the character of this. It was interesting you said as the aria is progressing, then Figaro, she becomes aware that Figaro's listening, and you said something like that.
Oh, well, she's aware from the start.
I think so, yeah. And she's dressed already. She and the Countess have changed clothes, so you're dressed as the Countess. But Figaro, usually the way it's directed, he's not actually looking at you, but he can hear you and he knows your voice. And I personally, I believe, but this is something you have to discuss with the director every time you do the role, might be a different director. I personally believe that every single thing she says in the aria is really to Figaro. Yeah, it really makes sense, particularly at the very end when she says that she will crown his brow with her wedding wreath, is really what she's talking about, the wreath that you got married in. Yeah, because you haven't had a chance yet. You know, you did get married, but you know, still the day hasn't finished.
Yeah,
so, you know,
yeah.
Here we go. So I want to look at this recit, however, because these accompanied recits are very hard to make sense of. We need to give the listener, take them on a journey as well in your thoughts and your shaping up to the aria. And then when we get to the aria, I'm going to say something. So the music is, I love the way David's playing this. It's got... it's got some movement, but it's very Susanna music. Mm-hmm. But it also has this feeling of a little bit of bubbling excitement about what's going to happen. Tronzi al fine momento che godrò senza affanno in braccio al lido mio. You know, the moment's nearly here where I'm going to be in the arms of my beloved. She's saying that to Figaro. It's about Figaro, I mean.
Yeah.
You know, however he, in his jealous rage, believes that she's talking about being with the Count. So I think it's got written in the music some little rests in it, but the thought is going right through.
Okay.
Yep. So can we just try it from there? Are you deciding, I'm sorry, are you deciding, because you can have a choice, or the conductor will tell you what they want, of either starting Junze right on the first beat of the bar, the end of, or else after.
Waiting.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah. And why are you waiting? What reason have you got in your head?
It's kind of, that's probably the bustling of all the people. Leaving.
Yeah, it could
and
be that.
Suddenly,
yeah.
She's alone.
Yeah.
Finally, the night's arrived.
Sure. So let me hear you hear that silence. You see, that made more sense to me. So what you did, you went through a process of thinking beforehand and speaking out aloud what your thoughts would be and what you saw, and therefore it really helped you when you came to sing it. So that's often the difficult thing if you've got to do singers in an audition or as you're going to in the finals, come out, and the whole aria is out of context. You haven't had the three acts before to build up to this moment. So you have to instantly, in those four bars, run through all these feelings you've got, see all the people leaving, and then this feeling of excitement that at last the day's nearly finished and you're going to be with your husband. Yeah. So that really made sense. Just a couple of things. Braccio. We've got, in Italian, we've got these double consonants. And I think it's a misnomer because you think it's something about how you say the consonant, but it's actually really about how you say the vowel before it. Because I'm hearing you going braccio and all this explosive air is coming out. But it's braccio. Braccio, not braccio.
Okay.
So it's not the ch sound, it's how you do the up vowel, braccio, and really don't have such explosive consonants in Italian.
Braccio.
Braccio. braccio.
Braccio.
Can you, that was it. You just put a little bit more lower energy into that. Once more.
Braccio.
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 Oh, that one. Can you feel that difference?
Yeah.
How would you describe that?
It's like
in the feeling.
Comes to the edge and then
good. Okay. Well, you've got to think that. It's because sometimes if you put into words whatever, that when you've got a coach or a conductor or your teacher saying, yeah, that's the one, put it into words to describe it so that when you're on your own, you can replicate it.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's deal with that. Let's carry on now. So the next one, timide cuore, she's saying, go away, you anxieties.
Yes.
I thought you did that quite well. However, I didn't feel you led up to the end of it. You know, don't get out of my heart, my breast, like this. Petto, by the way.
Petto.
Yeah, exactly. A turbar non vini. Don't come and disturb this delight, this joy that I want to be experiencing. So just remind yourself of what you're saying, but it's all,
sure.
That is coming while David's playing the four bars before it.
All
right. Coming on the, you're coming on the beat, aren't you? Yeah, just the four bars before timide. These are the anxieties, here they are.
Timide cuore, uscite dal mio petto, a turbar non venite il mio diletto.
That's good, okay. So the feeling was great. Now I just want to just look at the Italian, just a couple of things in the rhythm of the words. Just speak for me, uscite.
Uscite dal mio petto.
Okay, that's good. So when you sang it, you said uscite dal mio petto.
Ah.
I'm exaggerating, but yeah. And the same as diletto went
on.
Yeah.
Uscite dal mio petto.
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 That's it.
A turbar non venite il mio diletto.
Non is a closed vowel.
Non venite il mio diletto.
Still slightly open for me. Non. That's it.
Non venite il mio diletto.
Mio diletto.
Mio diletto.
So personal pronouns. Mio, io, sua, tua, lui. The first vowel is long. So you can take your time with it. You won't.
Okay.
It's a recitative anyway. Yeah. You can just do your own rhythm. I didn't say that out loud. A turbar non venite, non venite il mio diletto. Yeah, diletto, petto, where was the other one in here? Braccio. You can feel what happens on the rhythm of the word every time.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's got a nice, and you, generally, the vowel will be open, generally. There are always exceptions to rules, but so petto is open, diletto, braccio, they're open. So it has a brightness to the vowel as well. Could we just do that once more? Perhaps David, two bars before timide cuore.
Timide cuore, uscite dal mio petto, a turbar non venite il mio diletto.
That's it. You have to practice your diletto. On the letto. Oh, well, you're doing an appoggiatura above, are you?
Io diletto.
I'm doing the same. Diletto.
Diletto.
That's it. Think open vowel, diletto.
Diletto.
That's getting better, yeah. So the support is on, stays on, it doesn't sink. Diletto, it stays on. The air is building up. Diletto. And it's almost.
Diletto.
That's good.
Diletto.
Got it, that's it. Okay. I have to keep practicing that. I think you've got a good coach who'll help you on that. I know who it is, and she'll work on that. Just like, this is not making sense. Non venite il mio. Just spending a lot of time. Well, let's move on. Now the music changes. Now she looks around and she's looking at the night and looking at the atmosphere and saying, you know, I know what I'm about to do. I know that what I'm about to do is deceptive, and I know that Figaro is going to think I'm singing about the count, and it's just like the night. It looks so beautiful, but it's coming along. It's two-faced as well.
Yeah.
I furti miei seconda. You know. Mm-hmm. So the music changes here. Can we just go from o come par? Listen. Much better, good. words. Notte, notte. So much better. I think because what I could hear was the text was making sense, the intention of it. You were thinking before you were thinking the thought before you had to sing it. Yeah. So I know it's really nerve-wracking singing in master classes in front of people and knowing that you're going to get corrected and in front of everyone, because normally you're singing lessons just in private, just you and the singing teacher and perhaps a nice sympathetic pianist with you in the room. But to have to have this in front of people makes you very nervous, and so the first time through it will often be... So I understand completely. But, you know, as an artist, you need to practice getting immediately into that character, immediately into those thought processes. Yeah. And one of the best ways, actually, is to sing in front of people as much as possible.
Right.
Now, we get on to this divine aria. Remember, she's in the Countess's costume. And she sings an aria that is very much unlike anything she sings in the whole opera before. As Susanna, you know, you've got the dressing up aria,
yeah.
You've got all those ensembles. The only one that you come slightly close to this type of singing is in the letter duet, where you're actually copying what the Countess is saying as she dictates a letter
right.
to you. Now, it's almost like the way the Countess would sing it, isn't it?
Absolutely.
It's got these very, very long phrases and very lyric. So I just felt it was a little bumpy sometimes as you were going through it. Actually, strangely, you got better as you went on.
Yeah.
Yeah. So just think that Susanna's actually trying to sing like the Countess almost here. David was frowning at me. Was that... So that's good. That had much more line in it. It's good. And also Mozart, unlike later, 150 years later, or 200, or even now, when the melody line goes up, you don't need to have it sticking out. Well, I would say in general. You need to physically and skillfully, as a singer, negotiate that interval.
Yeah.
So we don't get vieni, non tardar. Can we just try it directly in? I just stop. So I think the problem is you're putting a double consonant. Vieni, she's going vieni. And the moment you do that, the jaw is, sorry, I said I wouldn't talk about vocal technique, but I would just, that N is very soft, be aware where the tongue's going with that. But if you go and really grip it, then there's no way you're going to get that F. Directly in. So it's something to take to take to your teacher.
Yeah.
I know your teacher is fantastic, and he'll show you ways around it. You might want to practice that just on the vowels only. So to get rid of that tongue in there. Okay, vieni o vamo. It's wonderful. All the way through this aria, it's very, very sensual, this aria. It's very sexy because she knows, she's singing this to Figaro. And she keeps saying the word come, come, come love, come the night, come all the time. You know. So whenever you've got that word there, you just give it the warmth that it needs. So next, carrying on from bar 10, where we got to. Vieni ove, vieni ove amore, per goder tua bella. And then we've got just one little double consonant there. Tappe, so it's about the vowel and that nanosecond of silence. Tappe, not too much, you want to make it subtle, but I heard tappe, almost went right through. Vieni, you're beautiful. She ran all. You did beautiful work with your vowels through that. She's saying, "Come, love, and
to give where to happiness calls."
Well, to where love is calling you, amore tappello. Okay, from Vieni. Oh, just... So I've just got to stop. Notturna. Not notturna. Notturna. Sorry. Finché.
Finché.
So now we come to the next section in this aria where she's describing the sounds that are around her. So she's describing the murmuring of the brook or the stream that's there. In wonderful words, mormorai ruschel. Ruschel gives us the sound.
Yeah.
Very soft, not like a German, but yeah. Qui scherza loro, that are playing around in the breezes. So. Scherza, it's got that sound of playing, exactly. And this wonderful word, che è called dolce sussurro, is this wonderful Italian word for whispering. Sussurro. I think, for me, it's very descriptive, very onomatopoeic. So all of these sounds you can use a bit more than better. So David, perhaps, we can go directly on.
Qui.
That's it. That's much better. So good. Well done. Just a couple of things just to take to your coach or do with you. Laura, you've got an R vowel and an O vowel. I need to hear both of those. Yes, I didn't hear the S at the beginning. It's not a German S, but I didn't hear anything. Scherza, Laura. Okay, let's carry on. Kegel dolce. Well done, this is so much better than just the word ridono, which means laughing or smiling. And so, so basically, it's really interesting because we'll get up to this as well in Zoe's Verdi aria, this looking at nature, that's how nature actually helps this place and this situation, the spirit of the place. So the flowers are just smiling and laughing at each other because life is perfect, as far as you're concerned, with Figaro. Qui ridono. Needs a little rolled R.
Qui ridono I fioretti e l'erba è fresca.
Nice.
Ai piaceri d'amor qui tutto adesca.
Okay, so just tell everyone what that meant when you said that, ai piaceri d'amor.
Basically to the kind of flow of love that is everywhere outside.
Okay, so it's really important when you see, that's what I heard you singing at that, basically. So we don't want basically or generally. It really helps if you know exactly. I piacere. What's piacere?
To love.
Pleasures.
Oh, pleasure.
Love is amor. Oh. Amor, amour.
Yeah, okay.
Amor.
So it's not the verb.
Yeah. A piaceri d'amor. The pleasures of love, qui tutto, adesco, it's around me everywhere, right now. Here it is.
Yeah.
Can we just sing that? Sing that from I piacere.
I piacere d'amor, qui tutto adesco.
Again, so we don't go See if you can actually shape that with real, I know you can. Because this aria is perfect for it. And actually, I think I heard you do it once as well. So this is where she says, come, come, my love. I want to put my wreath that I just got married with on your head, on your brow. Mm-hmm. All right, so ti vola,
Ti vola fronte in coronare di rose.
Okay, can we try that again? That was beautifully sung, but it was rather like Verdi to me. So sensual in it that it's not blasted out.
Okay.
Ti vola.
Ti vola fronte in coronare di rose.
Well done. It's hard, good.
Ti vola fronte.
Close vowel, raw, raw. Yeah, that's it. So not rose, but rose.
Rose.
That's it, yeah. So you're thinking, these rose, it's wonderfully finished up with this imagery of you seeing the roses on Figaro. So you're thinking of Figaro at that moment. And they're an open vowel, raw, doesn't really say it at all.
No.
This beautiful, warm, linguistic close vowel is what I mean, not vocally closed. Yeah. Beautiful, beautiful singing. Fantastic. I'd love to see you do the whole role.
Thank you.
Thank you.